Good morning, everybody. Today I want to cover a little bit more of Samuel. I'm going to try and make a whole study at the end of my the videos I do, and then I'll add them to the commentary that is on my different sites, and then they'll have the videos. So for that reason, I'll try to focus a little more on that book besides commenting on Psalms, Gospel of John, the other things I'm reading. So yesterday, I should have done a video, but yesterday I went to see the guys at the old firehouse. Now, I have not been back to the fire department in Kingsville since I retired, which is 2008. And, you know, over the years when other guys had retired while I was still working, some of them would come like a lot. And I could tell because that's their routine. After 25 years or more, that's a routine, and it's difficult. But I probably am one of the few that, after I retired, I didn't go back, you know, that's 8 years. But I felt yesterday as I took the ride, I said, you know, I'm going to, and it was nice because, you know, I pulled up, I got there like at around 9 in the morning, because I normally don't leave here till about 11 if I'm going to go ride. But that morning was like a work day. When I got up, I said, oh, it's like I'm going to work today. And I got there, I would normally get there earlier than 9, but I got there yesterday at 9. And then I walked in the station, the trucks were out, just like I never left, because that pattern becomes ingrained in you. And I like that. But they did so many, the guys were surprised. And I was going to do a joke. I forgot to do the joke. And I was also going to, I made that silly video called Ogopogo. Look, the titles might be stupid, but I teach on those, all right? So I remember as I was going to the firehouse, I wasn't sure if my friend Joe was on duty. I didn't know if the shifts changed or what. And so if he was, I was going to do the, ask him, like, to turn on the camera and say, Joe, do you remember the Ogopogo story? Well, sure enough, the guys had already told me, oh, yeah, Joe found that video. I guess they found my YouTube videos. And, you know, all you got to do is Google the most professionally made YouTube videos ever, and, you know, my site pops up. Obviously, they found it because Steve, one of the guys, said, oh, Joe showed us, he found that Ogopogo video where I discussed, I'll have to link it now, I discussed, you know, something that happened at the firehouse, kind of funny then. So, the guys, you know, I guess they found that, and it was nice, and I forgot to do the joke. You know, I have jokes, like, I might be gone for 8 years and just go back because I think, oh, I'm going to go tell a joke. So, the joke was going to be, John, you know, what are you doing here? We haven't seen you in 8 years, which they kind of said. I said, you know, I got to, because I'm retired, and our system is called TMRS. It's a statewide retirement, Texas Municipal Retirement System. But ours is fire department. I was going to say, man, you know, because of the Brexit, you know, Obama, and this is actually true. I'll comment a little more in a minute. But the media now is all out, you know, making the Brexit, Britain breaking away from the European Union, making it look like it's a disaster. And so they're out now to push that narrative. And I got a letter from TMRS that said, the stipulations of your retirement check have changed. And I read it and it said, you got to go check the trucks every morning. You know, that was going to be the joke. I got to go in now, check the trucks, because the Brexit. So it was fun to see the guys. It was funny. Now, they did a lot of changes. By the way, I did go, if Joe is actually watching the video, I did go to Station 2, but the guys were out of the station. I even tried to get in. We used to leave doors unlocked just so I could look around. I know there's a lot of changes. The main firehouse, I should have done the video, because when I took the one picture of the guys, Sam and a few of the guys said, oh, John's going to make a video, so they must realize I make videos. And I said, no, this is just a picture. The main firehouse, boy, they fixed it nice. You know, really nice. They have a gym, and upstairs, gym and an upstairs and a whole separate building area that was not there. But the little station I worked at for many years, which was called Station 2, that little firehouse was it was very crappy, okay? It looked like it didn't even look like a firehouse, to be honest. But over the years, as I've driven by without stopping in, I noticed they really made some nice changes to that little fire station by the college. But it was funny, because my friend Steve, they're showing me around, and everything's nice, you know, the bathrooms, they redid everything. And I used to like to go on the roof in the mornings. The guys knew, like, if there was a run or whatever, they'd say, John's up on the roof, because I'd go out there and pray. And it was kind of just a common thing. You get away from the shift, and I was, like, out there in the morning praying. And I wanted to go to that spot. Sure enough, everything's new, everything's changed, everything's fixed. They got fountains at Station 2. I mean, and then I told Steve, I said, oh, there's the door still open to the roof. Believe it or not, that one door, just a simple door that was like real beat up and crappy, you used to have to kick it open. It's the same way. I couldn't open the door. I kind of laughed. I said, Steve, you didn't, you know, millions of dollars or whatever. He said, nah, they never change the door. And he was going to open it for me. I said, nah, that's all right, Steve. Just kind of, you know, I'll go back and see the guys. So that was it. I didn't get to do the joke on the retirement. Okay. I do want you to see something interesting that the media, as you watch. Now today, as I make these, they post a few days, so not late. So numbers are a little different when I do stocks. But you understand something. The last few days, the media, main story is how a couple of $1 trillion was lost in the market. Look, believe me, the market went down many more trillions people lost a few months ago. And when it went from 18,000, the Dow Jones Industrial Average, to 15,000. Right now, as of this morning, it's still in the 17,000 range. And the media is playing the fact that right now, as of this day, the Dow at 17,100 or 150, they're playing it as one of the worst market crashes ever. I kid you not. But yet, 4 months ago, 3 months ago, it was down about 8 times more than what it's been down after the Brexit. And so they are pushing that narrative for many of the reasons I told you. And that's just as dishonest, if you will, as the Ogopogo. I'm going to do Samuel. I wrote a few. Look at this now. I want you to see a few interesting things. I pray for all of our people. And I pray that dreams and visions and the promise we read about in Joel, the prophet Peter quotes it in Acts 2, that in the last days God will pour out his spirit upon all flesh. And there's going to be prophecies and dreams. And I always pray that for all of our community. I want to be able to teach Christianity, historic Christianity, the things you see me discuss, because I think that that's important for Christians to have, you know, knowledge and education. Wisdom builds the house, it says in Proverbs. Understanding establishes it, and through knowledge its chambers are filled with all pleasant and precious riches. There's a verse that says, wisdom and knowledge will be the stability of your times. So we don't worship at the intellectual, quote, tree of knowledge, meaning we don't see the tree of knowledge as the answer to everything. Christ is our life. But yet at the same time, Paul said, in understanding, be men. In understanding, be men. And Paul engaged somewhat with the intellectuals of his day in the famous sermon in Acts, I think it's chapter 17, at Mars Hill in the city of Athens. And Athens had a big history of intellectuals, because that was the Greek wisdom center, okay, for that day. And so he had somewhat of a debate, and there was some not knowledgeable of the philosophy and belief systems. And that chapter, if it's the right chapter, but I know the story's correct, it's the only actual systems of philosophy that are named, two of them are named right there in the Bible. It was the Epicureans and the Stoics. And Paul mentions that, and that's in the book of Acts. And it doesn't teach those whole philosophies, but Paul, as he was engaging with the intellectuals, had the ability. It's just like you see in the other letters of the New Testament in Galatians, when he's engaging with the Jewish people and those who were coming into the church, Christianity, and then they would go back to the law, back to works, and he's has the ability because he was trained. So what we have, what we should have in Christianity and in the church, is both the operating of the Spirit, where God, for instance, the dream I had the other day, and I didn't even know because I'm praying, and I have some that are significant at times, and God will speak to dreams. But, and when I, a day later, I thought, oh, where did I was looking on a site, on a computer, you know, as I'm doing all my notes and writing links and all, and there was like a page I had that said bathroom notes, and they were all typed, like a catalog. And I thought, well, and then I realized it was a dream. Well, what would that dream? Bathroom notes is simply, I have a few notes before I speak in the morning that I'll make. And then when I'm in like worship and praise in the morning, and I sit in the tub for a few hours, then I pray. So I might have a few, you know, hours, not just preparing to preach. It's then I'll be praying out here, and I do the prayer walk all. But then I'll have ideas. So that's inspiration. So what I saw in the dream, I realized, oh, that was a dream. And it just meant not preach all the bathroom notes, but it meant speak out of inspiration, meaning whatever God's communicating at the moment. The scripture says, open your mouth, and I will fill it. Okay? There's one in the book of Job, which I like. I put that one in my other room. It says, I should go read it to you. But there's a spirit in man, and the inspiration of the Almighty gives them understanding. And that's from Job, if I remember, but that's a verse. There's a spirit within man, and the inspiration of the Almighty gives them understanding. So that's God speaking prophetically, even if you don't call it prophecy. When you're just speaking off the cuff, whatever God wants to communicate. I want to do a little bit of Samuel before I forget, and then mention a psalm and a little bit from Timothy. Well, let me do the psalm right now. I'm reading a lot of the psalms and proverbs as well, but the other day from King David, who we're going to get to, ties into the book of Samuel, but David said, "You have delivered my soul from death. Will you not deliver my feet from falling, that I might walk in the light of the living?" Now, I found that interesting. He didn't say that I might walk in the land of the living, which those themes you also find in Psalms, but that I may walk in the light of the living. So what is he saying in that psalm? You've delivered my soul from death, but now, be able, you must be able, I know you're able, to deliver my feet from falling so I can walk in the light of the living. And Jesus in the New Testament, all through the scriptures, it says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Jesus says, there are so many hours in the day, walk in the light and you will not stumble. Meaning, if you're walking in God's will daily, that's the kingdom. But you cannot walk in that will. You cannot have those visions, dreams, all the things that are real necessary for you to fulfill your mission if you're walking in sin. And God's gracious, and you might have battles in your life, but if you're walking in known bondage, okay, known sin, whatever, if I was really convicted about the smoking, I'm not, I'll be honest with you. But if I was, and it was a battle, and I'm trying to go ahead, and that would be a hindrance to me. And I'm not, this whole thing's not about smoking. I'm just saying, David said, there are certain feet from falling. There are certain, in Hebrews it says, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that does so easily beset us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us. So there's certain things that, and you know what they are. Whatever you, whoever you are, you know what they are. And so those things will keep you from walking in that mystery of the kingdom. Okay? Many years ago, sometimes when I'm meditating, doing my studying, and then I have an old journal, and I put some old pictures of New Jersey and all, and I was thinking the other day, when I first really started getting into ministry, you know, in the early days, and then I'd go back to New Jersey, North Bergen, and visit my family. My dad was nice, and so they had an old, in the sense that, oh, I'm going to sit John up to preach at a church or something, which was good. And so there was an old chaplain. His name was Reverend Wilkins, and he was an old chaplain in an old Church of God church. Not, you know, it was, that was the type, I think it was, a Church of God church. And but he was the chaplain for the fire department. Very nice man. And he had a little church right there where I go. My hometown, used to kind of pass that block on the way to school as a kid. And so my dad knew I was starting preaching. This is back in the 80s. And so I'm going to make a visit to New Jersey. And I didn't want to preach while I was in New Jersey because, you know, it was like I was taking a break when I went back to visit. I was still at the firehouse at that time and, you know, fly back and visit my family. And this was in the early days, 80s. But he said, son, my dad told me, I spoke to the chaplain, Reverend Wilkins of the fire department, and he wants you to preach at his church on a Sunday while you're back. And I really didn't want to, but it was okay. And so, you know, and it was early in my ministry in Texas and firehouse, but a lot was just going with the flow, is what I'm saying. Not, a lot of that was not planned, organized. You just went with the will of God for your life. And so, and then I preached. And I remember some of my friends. One of my friends that's on Facebook right now, I remember they went to see me preach back in the 80s. And I remember some of the friends, and it was a big, a fairly nice congregation. I forget what I preached on. Then I got good comments maybe from my mother's friends who went that week or whatever. But God will give you a platform. And I remember I left a book, one of the first books. The first book I wrote, I published it with a little publishing house. And I don't have any of those copies, but they're on the website, the House of Prayer, Den of Thieves. And I used to give those little books away. I gave one to that preacher, Reverend Wilkins. And he sent me a very nice note, mailed me a note. He said, because he was a humble man. He passed away since, but he was a humble man. Not a big, flamboyant, you know, a lot of money church, mega, whatever it is. If you're a mega church, I'm not criticizing you. But he was just an old type pastor, you'd think. And he liked that book. He said, this is, because he lived his whole life just serving without a lot of fame, a lot of, but God organizes, he'll direct your steps. And David was saying, you were able to deliver me, God, from my soul from death now. Let me walk in that light. Because if I'm in these other paths, I won't be able to enjoy that journey. Walk in the Spirit. And there's, and you have to have, I could do a lot on this key of David, things I'm reading in Scripture. But David, he's saying God's all around him. And the key, one of the keys, Jesus is the key of David, okay? Books are written on a lot of it. In New Testament, I won't do it all. But he says, he looked to the rock. He understood, in the great kingdom God, we're going to read about that God used David to build, King David. We're going to read about some of the story in Samuel coming up. He had many things going on. He had subjects, people under his authority. He had taken area, territory. Great image of an apostolic or apostle type ministry. And in all that, he establishes this central place of praise. It was called the Tabernacle of David, but it was a place where we'll talk about the ark and all, but he understood that all of it was dependent upon this open heaven. Deliver my feet from falling, he said, so I can walk in that. That all these other things, that his kingdom and things happening, and his son wrote the, Solomon wrote the great wisdom literature, the Old Testament, Ecclesiastes, Proverbs. But David said, this is the key. And you know, when you read Proverbs, I'll read stuff like Solomon saying, my father taught me this. The proverb is saying to us as we read it, he says, I was my father's son and he taught me. And I think, wow, David sat down with Solomon. He said, son, these are the things that count. So this is a family heritage when you read scripture. Samuel chapter 4. We ended chapter 3 of Samuel with the, it's really the last verse of Samuel 3. I would probably add it when I put the verses. It says, because the word of the Lord comes to Samuel at that time, God manifests and reveals himself, and it goes out to all Israel. Let's see, chapter 3, I'll read a few verses. This is Samuel 3. And the Lord appeared again in Shiloh, for the Lord revealed himself to Samuel in Shiloh by the word of the Lord. I've got to put my cigarette down. So, the Lord is appearing through his word, through the prophet now. He's going to start communicating to Samuel. And the word of Samuel came to all Israel. So God has that vessel, Samuel, dedicated. And everybody knows he's a prophet once they start hearing what God's speaking through him. And the word of Samuel comes to all Israel. Then they have this war with the Philistines. Now they're going to go out and fight, but the prophecy in chapter 3 and the first few chapters of Samuel was Eli and his two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, the priesthood. They got wicked. They were away from God. And so really the first prophecy that God gives to Samuel when God's calling him and Samuel finally says, speak, it was one of judgment. The house of the wicked priesthood right at that time is going to be judged. So we're going to see it fulfilled now. They go out to fight. Now, they go out to fight, and it's significant, okay? Some of the teachers, scholars, theologians, they'll tell us, don't confuse the area where they're fighting in chapter 4 with chapter 7, okay? What does this mean? Okay, they're going to go fight the Philistines, and they encamp, the children of Israel encamp, a little area called Ebenezer. Ebenezer means stone of help. Stone of help, rock of help. Ebenezer. There are famous songs. I used to sing them in the Baptist church. Here I raise my Ebenezer. And I used to think, what does that mean? Well, the Ebenezer is a word that means stone or rock of help. Now, why do some Bible teachers say, make sure you don't confuse the Ebenezer mentioned in chapter 4 with that of chapter 7, which I have not gotten to yet. Because in chapter 4, the Ebenezer, which is a type of Christ, rock of help, stone of help, is the place where the children of Israel suffer a great defeat. They go to fight the Philistines. It's a famous story now. And when they go to fight the Philistines, they suffer defeat because God said he was going to judge the house. And they're kind of confused why they start losing to the Philistines. And as they're at war, they decide, we know what to do. This is God's people, the children of Israel. They said, let's go back to the tabernacle in Shiloh, the place where God's holy place was, which had the ark of the covenant, which I'm looking at my model of it right here. So in, I'll teach a little, I guess. In chapter 4, the children of Israel go to fight the Philistines. The Philistines win. And the children of Israel are a little shocked. So they say, the children of Israel say, this is a model of the Ark of the Covenant. They've got to make sure it's on there. Okay. So they go back. They go back to Shiloh, where that little box was larger. That's a model of it. And when they go back to Shiloh, sort of like the holy area, they say, let's take this Ark of the Covenant, this box that God told us to establish, the whole story of the Ark of the Covenant, I won't do it. But let's take it. It represented God's presence among the people. They said, let's take this box and let's bring it into the battle. God will be with us if we have the box. So chapter 4, Samuel, they get the box, they bring it in. Now, the Philistines hear a big shout in the camp among God's people. They said, what could that be? And they hear, word gets back, they went and got that ark. That ark, they went and got it, and they brought it back with the two priests, Hophni and Phinehas, who were wicked, who God already said, I'm going to judge your house. Well, the Philistines do something interesting, and I want you to get this. Even though they say, oh no, there is terror in the camp of the Philistines, God is with them. And even the Philistines, from their own mouth, the testimony of pagans, this is the God that did all those things in Egypt with Moses. How he destroyed Pharaoh and all that, we can't fight him. The testimony went out, you see. Even the pagans knew it. But then, the leaders of the Philistines say, it doesn't make a difference. Just be strong. Act like men and fight. The same instructions Paul gives to Timothy, which I'm reading through Timothy right now in the New Testament. So, the Philistines, even in their misunderstanding of their religion, even in their misunderstanding of God, not having the true God, because they had pagan gods, yet there was a biblical principle that they implemented. Please understand. And the biblical principle was, fight like your life depends on it. Even though the other side has got the better theology. Because the other side that has the better theology, they've forsaken God. And whether or not they're a quote Christian nation, whether or not they have it downright, their doctrines, the fact is, that box to them is just a box because they don't obey the things that are written in it, which are the commandments. ISIS. Why does ISIS have success? You know, a study was done. I heard it recently on PBS radio. But they could not figure out why a lot of our guys coming back from the fighting and wars that are going on right now in the world. The rate of PTSD, do you know that PTSD, the ISIS fighters, because studies have been done, they have zero. Wait a minute. You mean the ISIS fighters who are fighting the United States of America and the great Western power, the country with the box, who don't obey what's in it. John, are you defending them? No, you're not hearing me. Why do they have no PTSD? They looked at this. Because what we found out is the guys coming back, the rate of suicide for our fighters is so high, they realized it wasn't just PTSD. It's misdiagnosed. They said there's a natural principle that when you as a country are fighting anywhere in the world. I like that cloud. Looks like the hand of God. I look at the clouds a lot. When you as a country are fighting anywhere in the world, and the people that you're fighting, if they believe that their life is on the line, meaning they're not just out fighting because there's political reasons. They're not just in battle and the populace of their home country is living a normal life, watching football games on TV and disconnected from it. And then you happen to be in the military of that country and they send you somewhere and then you're sent to an area where those people, whether right or wrong in their minds, they believe their cause is one of survival for them. The people defending what they feel is their land do not suffer the same PTSD than the other foreigners going to the land suffer. That's the study that was done. It's amazing, isn't it? My friend Jesse, who I talk about sometimes, the Xanax planted on him. But he told me once in one of the Bible studies I was doing, I think Jesse fought in Iraq, but he said, you know, John, he said, when he was there, one of the tours, somebody from an Iraqi just told him, might have just been someone from the street, and said, what are you doing here? We live here. This is where we live. And you're coming all the way from the other side of the world to fight us. And you know, it wasn't a propaganda thing. It didn't come from ISIS or another. It came just from an Iraqi there. And it made my friend just think. All the training made him think. So the Philistines are putting in place a principle. And the principle is, we're going to fight courageously, like our lives depend on it. And even though the other side claims to be, they have the God of the box with them, what they don't realize is that's all they got is a box. Because God has already pronounced judgment. Because they've broken those commandments, those laws that are written in that box. And that box was not supposed to be some type of a fortune thing. You're not supposed to just hold to Christianity and religion as some type of it's there, but we don't actually obey God himself. And that's where Israel was at. So, the Philistines fight, and sure enough, their courage, putting their life on the line for what they believed was right, even though they were wrong, theologically, they won. Now, they won because God already pronounced judgment. We're going to see it in a second. God already said, I've left you. You might have the box, but my presence is not there. Because what happens in the story of Samuel 4, I'll mention, if I remember, the two Ebenezers, they have a great defeat, the people of God, at an Ebenezer, which is meant to be Rock of Help. But in chapter 7 of Samuel, that Rock of Help, Samuel is going to set one up as a memorial where God does give him a great victory. So, the rock represents Christ, and the scholars that say, don't confuse them. I understand what they mean, but you got to get the picture, brother. The picture is, you got to be broken first at the place of the Ebenezer. Jesus said, whoever falls on this stone will be broken, but whoever it falls on, it grinds him to powder. So you could say in chapter 4, they fell on that stone. They had to realize their sin, God's people. And then later in chapter 7, the great Ebenezer, it's going to fall on the enemy. And they'll be ground to dust. But that's the significance of the two Ebenezers. We don't want to miss that. You come broken to the cross, then you're going to have the great victory. Of here I raise my Ebenezer. Later we'll get to that. So the ark, the box, is taken. The Philistines actually capture that ark. Now, the holy place of Shiloh, where the father of the two priests who got killed this day, Hophni and Phinehas, the judgment of Samuel, the word of the Lord, was fulfilled, and Hophni and Phinehas were killed. And a messenger comes back from the tribe of Benjamin, runs back to the city, goes to Shiloh, where the father, Eli, the old man who raised Samuel, taught Samuel, it says he was sitting there, but he was blind. And I don't want to be derogatory, and it says he was fat, which is, again, in Scripture, that's a sign of you're lazy. You've left judgment. Your eyes are dim. And so the old man, I think he was 98 or something, is the father of the priests, Hophni and Phinehas, he's listening. What happened? And the messenger came back from the front, and he said, your sons are killed. Hophni, but that's not what Eli's... Oh,
What about the ark? What about the box? They said they took the box. The Philistines have it. Now, when he hears that, it says he falls back in his chair and breaks his neck and dies. The judgment of God from Samuel, the prophetic word from that young boy, came to pass in that chapter. That's the Ebenezer. That was the rock. Don't mistake that, scholars, because that was the rock too. That was God's word coming to pass. Now, the two priests, Hophni and Phinehas, the wife of Phinehas hears all this news. Her father-in-law is dead. Her husband Phinehas is dead. The box is stolen. But she was pregnant. And when she hears all this, it's such disaster. It says she goes into labor. And she's going to have a child. And the handmaidens and all say, oh, you're going to have a baby. It's don't worry. But she at that point, she says, it's too late. Don't make a difference. She's dying, giving birth to a boy. And she names him Ichabod, which meant the glory has departed. That's chapter 4. The word of God came to pass. And remember, the prophet Amos said, woe unto you that are wanting the word of the Lord. Remember that? Woe unto you that are looking forward to God's word. Because that was God's word. You say, we want the day of the Lord. They got it in chapter 4. God began speaking again. Manifesting again. That's how it started. Let's see. I did 2 Timothy. I think I'll skip it for now. I was going to do a few more things about Paul will be teaching the New Testament. He says, when Christ appears, when Christ comes, also we understand the Spirit is Christ. So there are things that David, it could go back to the psalm I was quoting earlier, let me deliver my feet from falling so I could walk before God in the light of the living. The only way you'll ever accomplish the things God's called you to do is by the Spirit of God, okay? And when he comes, he gives life. The words in the box had meaning. But Paul said in the New Testament, the whole Old Covenant, the circumcision, outward circumcision of the flesh, the words, outward law, he said to his fellow Jews, he says, the name of God is blasphemed by the Gentiles because of you. Saying that to his fellow Jews, because they had the box in the New Testament, they had all these wonderful things, and their hearts were not changed. And Paul says, it's the circumcision of the heart that matters, the law written on the heart. When the Gentiles do the things that were contained in the law by nature, that's what matters. So, we as the church today, we do these battles, okay? We do a lot of things going on in the world. And yet, we just had, I'm not going to tie it all to abortion. There's just an abortion law. And it's access and freedom. And many of the women honestly believe they were almost celebrating. Yay! The abortion side won because there was just a Supreme Court ruling last night. This divided court, but Anthony Kennedy ruled on the side of the pro-abortion and against the side of the pro-life. It had to do with the Texas case. But basically, the Supreme Court... Now, if you look at the women that won, because the abortion people won at the Supreme Court, to put it short. But they were so happy. Why? Because we could exercise our right to health care. Let me ask you, wouldn't it be better that we would never have to abort any children? You've lost that. Wouldn't it be better? You almost see it as a right of wonderful freedom to abort a child. It's been turned into like a celebratory right of freedom. It's not that. Even Bill Clinton said in the early days, he said, we want it to be rare. But if it had to be done, it would be much better that none of that would happen, that we would not get unwanted pregnancies. Why are these rulings so bad? We live in a time, medical doctors will testify, because of the advance of medicine, there were days where we did not have the ability to do what's called cesarean section, which means even if a woman is 3 months pregnant and she has physical problems in order to save her life, do you know there is hardly never, ever a case where you would have to do an abortion, very minuscule, to save a woman's life, because we have what's called cesarean section. And it's not a traumatic surgery. And if you have very small cases, you know, less than 1%, but yet it's practiced as something that we celebrate. And many of the abortions that are performed are not for that. And they could define a woman's health. That's what people fight. You could define, I got an abortion because of my health reasons. Do you know health reasons could simply mean a woman is 6 months pregnant and she really can't afford to have a child? That can almost fit in. Okay, it might be an undue stress for you to raise a child. Well, we'll abort that child. Now, let me say something. I know that the women that were very happy about the ruling, they are sincerely happy. And they're talking about it almost as it's just a wonderful right that whenever it's accessed and used, it should be celebrated. No, no. Even those in the original pro-abortion movement said it would be better to prevent the pregnancy than if we have to take it full term and give the child. Or if you're having medical complications, we do cesarean. We do a surgery, which we've never been able to do, you know, in the early days, and we just take the child out. Well, I wouldn't want to have the scar. Well, now then the question is it a scar or is it a life? We got to reevaluate, because we keep thinking in the country that we have the box. We have all this Judeo-Christian ethic. Okay, we'll end with that. So I did the Ogopogo. Forgot to do the joke with the TMRS. If you guys get to watch it, that's why I showed up. TMR sent me a letter. Because of the Brexit, Obama's pissed off, and he's going to make all the retired firefighters got to go and check the trucks. And that's it. I thought I had something else I wanted to show you, but I got a lot of verses all over. The scripture says, it's God that builds his stories in the heavens. I like this verse. It's in the house. It's not out here. It's God that builds his stories in the heavens and establishes his troops on the earth, the kingdom. We're going to read about David as we continue in the story of Samuel. We're going to read some great stuff. But he builds that place of worship in the middle of the city of God, the city of David. It's Jerusalem. David dwelt in the house, it says, and he called it the city of David. And he built round about from the surrounding terraces and inward. And the Lord was with David, and the Lord blessed David for the sake of his people Israel. I just remembered, that was another thing. How do you remember all the links and all that? It's very hard, but I got to be led of God if he brings to my remembrance. So I'm going to link the Alamo video that I made 20 videos ago in San Antonio, because I remember I talked about David. So it's not the intellect that's going to help me do research and do all that. It's okay, you be led of the Spirit, even when in every aspect. So I'm going to link it, because I just remembered I need to link that. Okay, God bless you guys. I want you to learn, go through these studies, use them, and read the book of Samuel, because there's a lot of really important things for us to learn. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you. The Lord be gracious unto you. And the Lord give you peace. I want you to see that ark. The angels. The two angels. We read about that in the chapter. And that's his angels are among us, okay? Amen.